We're not just making music, and we talk about other things, and it becomes your life. And it does translate into what you're doing in your music in a funny sort of way. You only realize it in retrospect.
How did you find some sort of grounding point or understanding of what you were trying to make?
I think one of the big things was getting into our own studio eventually. You know, that's how we'd always envisaged making the album, would be in our own place.
It was a way of sort of trying to start again, which is what I wanted to do. You know, I wanted to stick with these people and make music because I know that the sum total of what did we do is far better than what I would do on my own or with Johnny.
We could actually have all these different elements, you know, for recording, for rehearsing, all the artwork being put together there, any kind of a visual side of it. So once you can actually see all those things coming together in one place and they're all playing off of each other, you know, that creates a real momentum in itself.
Even when it sort of feels like you're totally shooting yourself in the foot, you're not really, because you're just following the, you know, you've been put on earth to do a particular thing and you do that.
And it's survival.
And yeah, there comes a point where you really have to start apologizing for it, really.
Stop apologizing?
Yeah.
For sure.
Just get on with it. It's just such a precious thing to create a space where you go and you work and it's creative, but it's pure anarchy as well. It's really fun.
Oh, it's going to sound incredibly touchy-feely, but just five of us, well, and with Nigel as well, just sitting down as having endless talks and debates at points about, you know, what had happened for the past 7 years of being signed and 14 years of working together as a band, and just trying to be as honest as possible with each other about, you know, what we wanted out of our working arrangement.
In the studio, everybody's sort of, it's got this gallery area, and that's where Stanley is. And
who's Stanley?
The guy who does the artwork. Okay. with us. Well, he does it already. I go up there and I'm mess around with him while the others are doing stuff downstairs, and we shout down and stuff, and they shout back.
That sounds fun.
Yeah, it's really good fun, actually. So, I mean, you know, it goes late onto the night, early into the morning, and by the end of it, everybody just feels terrible because we're all drunk or whatever. You just can't feel anything. But it's great, you know. Obviously, you can't do it for months on end because you go completely la-la. Anyway, so these words came out of, like, all the notes and all the bits and pieces that weren't... that were left. And we just thought, we don't want to lose these, you know. And we just started putting them together and realised that there was this basic stream of consciousness thing running right through, and it was kind of like, wow, that's a bit scary. It just starts in one place and it gets to you. I mean, and to me, it makes perfect sense.
I slip away. I slipped on a little white lie. We've got heads on sticks. You've got ventriloquists standing in the shadows at the end of my bed. The rats and the children follow me out of town. Come on, kids! Bodies floating downstream, the truckloads of machetes. The cameras are turning off. You can watch birds picking over the bodies, the cameras and the flies. Too much to drink. And on and on and on. Very disturbing images. It's almost felt like I was, it's almost like an explosion of Tourette's you're having there.
Yeah. Thrust up in tuxedos with the orchestra at the ball, and it slides like slime through your wallpaper walls. With a grin like roadkill and the bloody power of kings, I sneeze and it's an exorcist, I cough a new disease.
You didn't have a single, you didn't have a video, you had the blips, and yet it goes to number one on the Billboard. I mean, you are charting a different route, and you know, you don't have to tour ad nauseum.
Yeah.
You can still...
It's pretty pointless as well.
What is the aspect that makes it such a grind?
You disassociate yourself from the moment, from the world around you, from the people you know, because you've basically, you know, become this monster.
The the typical touring in arenas, the way in which artists are put through the bowels of the music industry and promotional machine.
I know other people in other bands at the moment being forced into doing things that really, knowing them and knowing how delicate they are, they really should not be doing them.
I used to really like doing these pieces, but I really hate them now. I don't hate them, it's like, get really incoherent. Sorry, Ted.
I'm sorry about that.
No, I'm sorry. I don't hate it, it's not true.
But the pressure that they're under to do these things is too much and they can't handle it, so they cave in.
I think you feel that you're actually trying to shoehorn yourself into a very established cycle.
There are ways to break the mold.
If we had 9 months scheduled, then I would have snapped in a week, you know, but we basically, the whole thing's over 2 weeks' time. Over, that's it, you know. And then we decide what to do next year, and I can't tell you how good that feels.